Thank you. Thank you. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Alexander Betts, and I'm Director of the Humanitarian Innovation Project. On behalf of the entire project team, I'm delighted to welcome you all to Oxford, the global capital of humidity and tropical storms. Around the world, we face a vast array of serious humanitarian challenges. The number of people affected by humanitarian crisis has doubled over the last decade. This year, it's estimated that some 52 million people will receive international humanitarian assistance. And it's been recently announced that we've seen more people displaced in the world today than any time since the Second World War. You only have to turn on the news to see the crises unfolding in Gaza, Syria, South Sudan, and Iraq, to know that the topic we're trying to address at this conference is a very serious one. Yet there's hope. Gradually, in the face of recognition that humanitarians can and should do better, there is a turn towards innovation, a shift towards trying to think creatively, to reach outwards beyond the humanitarian sector, to look for ideas, solutions, products and processes that can inspire better work to meet the challenges we face today and in the future. Reflecting the emergence of humanitarian innovation, the World Humanitarian Summit has recently announced that humanitarian innovation will be one of its core thematic areas. Many of the people here in this room are doing very important and significant work in this area, across the United Nations sector, NGOs, civil society, business in the private sector, and of course, last but not least, universities. But what we need to do is ensure that we talk to one another, that we engage in dialogue, that we make the most of our capacities, and we talk across sectors, across organizations, and use our skills collectively. In this context, HIP2014 aspires to play a convening role, to bring people together, to engage in dialogue, and create new forms of collaboration. Our aim for this conference is very different from most academic conferences. We want it to be more than just a talking shop. We want it to lead to change and impact in the world and inform your work. With that in mind, we want to set you a challenge in the next few days as individuals, which we're going to call the 3-2-1 challenge, if you like. We'd like you, by the end of the conference, to be able to identify at least three big ideas that you've heard that have inspired you. We'd like you to be able to identify at least two new people that you haven't met before that you're going to keep in touch with after the conference. And we'd like you to think of at least one thing that you will do differently when you go home. So for all of you, there's that 3-2-1 challenge, and I'll be asking some of you towards the end of the conference how you've thought about those ideas and what you can take from this conference. We hope that the vast array of panels and inspirational speakers will inspire you to develop new thoughts, new ideas, new networks, and ways of doing things when you go home. At the outset, though, I need to thank and acknowledge a number of people who have played a very important role in making this conference happen and bringing you all here today. First of all, I wish to sincerely thank Stephanie Hunt, who has funded the work of the Humanitarian Innovation Project and this conference and nurtured it from its inception, who's here today with her daughter, Natalie, who's joining us at the conference. We warmly welcome you, Natalie, and you, Stephanie. We're also to our main institutional partners, UNHCR and Gotcha, who have worked with us to enable us to do our field work, who have supported this conference, and who have a significant presence here today and tomorrow. The Norwegian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the Oxford Department of International Development, and the Centre for International Studies have also contributed to the conference. But I also want to acknowledge at the start, rather than just at the end of the conference, the huge contribution of the entire HIP team. You'll see a small army of people wearing blue HIP polo shirts around, and they'll be on hand if you need advice or guidance during the 2 days. They've done extraordinary work, largely as volunteers. And they've been guided, coordinated by Nina Weaver and Fabio Picara, who are supportive with the logistics and will also be on hand if you need any support and guidance. As well as the entire team at Oxford, we're also really glad that some of our team who have worked with us in Uganda are present today. In particular, Robert Hakiza and Takimazi Nzionivira have joined us as collaborators in our work who have worked with us in Uganda. They've set up inspiring collaborative projects working with refugees in Uganda. And we're delighted that despite the best efforts of my government, they've been able to travel here and attend the meeting. All of the information you need, from Wi-Fi to water to dinner this evening, should be in your programs and welcome packs. But if you have any questions, just look for the people in the blue polo shirts. I only want to make a few small, brief housekeeping announcements. The first thing is to say that David Nibbs and Chris Kelly, our colleagues from Dallas, will be filming and taking photographs during the 2 days. If for whatever reason you're uncomfortable with being filmed or photographed, just let any of the team know, and we're ensure that your image is not inappropriately published. We'll also be running a live Twitter feed based on the conference at hashtag HIP2014. Please, if you feel the urge to contribute to that, we'd strongly encourage you to do so. I also am obliged to say that in the very unlikely event of a fire, the college has urged you to join the nearest quad, which in this case is the immediate grassy area outside. But that's obviously extremely unlikely to happen. In order to set the scene for this conference, and before I introduce our keynote speaker, the Deputy High Commissioner for Refugees, we want to give a little bit of background to the Humanitarian Innovation Project and the work that we've been doing. We want to show you a video to do that, a very short video, which reflects the ethos of our entire project. It's based upon collaborative effort. Much of the filming for the video was done by a refugee researcher, Devon Kay, based in the Nakivale settlement in Uganda, supported by one of our partners, David Nibbs in Dallas, and produced here at the Refugee Studies Center in Oxford. So this is an introduction to the work of the Humanitarian Innovation Project.
There is a growing recognition that the humanitarian system is not working as it should. Traditional assistance models are inefficient, unsustainable, and hugely expensive. The world is changing rapidly, and you, the creative solution, are urgently needed. In response, there is an emerging innovation term in the humanitarian world. Traditional humanitarian organizations are gradually exploring new partnerships, the role of technology, and the role of the private sector. The very idea of innovation, more commonly used in the private sector, is being integrated as a methodology for adaptation and change. Up to now, a significant and growing part of the humanitarian innovation debate has focused on improving organizational response, piloting new products and processes in areas as diverse as health, shelter, and energy. But an additional, and sometimes neglected, part of that debate is the innovation of crisis-affected communities themselves. Refugees offer one example of the need and potential for humanitarian innovation. A Around the world, over 10 million of the world's 15 million refugees are in so-called trafficked refugee situations. Most of them stuck in camps or settlements for many years. They often don't have the right to work or freedom of movement, and they're indefinitely dependent on humanitarian assistance. This represents both talent and human potential. The Humanitarian Innovation Project was created in 2012 with an initial mission to undertake research in the role of innovation, technology, and the private sector in refugee assistance. From the beginning, our guiding ethos was a focus on bottom-up innovation by refugees themselves. Beginning with research in Uganda, we have tried to recognize that refugees have skills, talents, and aspirations. They have to adapt to new markets, social networks, and regulatory environments. Yet despite the constraints, displaced populations are frequently part of vibrant economic systems. They are entrepreneurial and frequently innovative. We chose to focus the study on Uganda because it represents a relatively positive case. It is a country in which the government has taken the step to allow refugees the right to work and a significant degree of freedom of movement. It therefore shows the boundaries of the possible if refugees can face it levels of freedom. Our research focuses on two refugee settlements, Mekibali and Chengoli, and the capital city, Kampala. In addition to lots of interviews and focus groups, we conducted a survey with 1,600 refugees.
Throughout the work, we've taken a participatory approach. Our research team was made up of refugees from the communities that we were serving. This approach not only gave us really valuable and important insights, but also allowed us the opportunity to feedback something to the community through the training.
I realize how the potential
our research findings challenge five popular assumptions, five common myths about the economic lives of refugees. That refugees are economic domestics, that they're a burden on host states, that they're economically homogenous, that they're technologically illiterate, and that they're dependent on the humanitarian system. In each case, our data challenges or at least fundamentally nuances each of these assumptions. The refugee context in Uganda highlights for us the potential for innovation within the so-called affected communities, within all times and stages of humanitarian crisis. It has led us to consider ways that humanitarian crisis can become the basis of sustainable opportunities and to look systematically at innovation spaces around the world to understand how bottom-up innovation might be facilitated to empower affected communities to help themselves. Broadening from our initial refugee focus, HIP is now working to involve a range of humanitarian actors across the United Nations, NGOs, the private sector, the military, and community-based organizations on ways in which the skills, talents, and aspirations of affected communities can be better mobilized to improve humanitarian response. Our research aims to be relevant to both academia and practice. While many people are now working within the broad area of humanitarian innovation, our particular focus places the affected populations at the heart of our analysis. While retaining a focus on refugees, we're building on these initial insights to rethink how humanitarian innovation can be better adapted to build sustainable opportunities for affected communities across the emergency, protracted, and recovery phases of crisis. Our work is just one piece of a much broader tapestry. Many people and organizations are today working directly or indirectly on key aspects of humanitarian innovation. To harness our collective potential, dialogue and collaboration are needed more than ever, particularly across sectors. Every one of us here today represents part of a humanitarian ecosystem. whether it's governments, international organizations, NGOs, business, community-based organizations, universities, or individuals. HIP2014 aims to play a convening role within that ecosystem. As the first major academic conference on humanitarian innovation, HIP2014 aims to stimulate dialogue and seeks to support the development of new ideas and networks. Over 2 days, we will explore questions such as how to improve organizational response, how to engage with the community, and how to be critical about humanitarian innovation. We hope that by working together, we can turn humanitarian challenges into sustainable opportunities for all. We warmly welcome you all.
Now I'm delighted to be able to introduce our opening keynote speaker. Alexander Aleinikoff is the Deputy High Commissioner for Refugees and he's been in that position at UNHCR since 2010. Before that, he's had an illustrious career as Dean of the Georgetown Law Center and as Executive Vice President of Georgetown University. He's also served the Obama-Biden administration by co-chairing the transition team on immigration and serving before that in the Clinton administration as General Counsel at the Immigration and Naturalization Service. I think he's an ideal keynote speaker for this topic because during his term as Deputy High Commissioner, he's overseen so much of the transformation in the organization to embrace innovation, to establish UNHCR innovation, to modernize the work of the organization. Perhaps most importantly though, he's embraced the idea of self-reliance and empowering refugees in the work of the organization. Alex, we're delighted to welcome you to the conference and to have you as our keynote speaker.
So if your name's not Alex, we're going to change it to Alex and introducing Alex is here. Look, I want to congratulate the organizers for bringing us all together. It's really remarkable. We've come from many different places and organizations and interests and the program is exceedingly full and interesting. So Alex, congratulations to you and the colleagues and the organization for the project. That's strong as well. So we're glad to thank you all to be here. I'm excited about the range of panels and presentations. And I say that from the perspective of the user, if I can, from UNHCR. I expect I'll learn a lot that will assist our efforts in making humanitarian work more effective and more reflective. The panels show a rather inclusive definition of innovation. So there are talks on new technologies, on information systems, ways to display information, on livelihoods, on educational strategies, on the training of humanitarian workers, even several sessions on ethics in humanitarian work. It's quite capacious. I'm tempted to think that one could put a chapeau over all these presentations and say that really they're all in the category of new good ideas. And I'm fine with that if that's our working definition of innovation, because to me it's not what innovation is, not an academic definition, but rather what it does, and I think that's what brings us here together. The way I think about innovation, the way I try to mobilize it inside my organization, I would say I use the following description. But to me, innovation represents strategies for problem solving that rely on previously unused modalities and products and seek to benefit from the minds of many both within and beyond UNHCR. Now, maybe that conception is appropriate to the humanitarian community as a whole, and I recognize that the phrase the minds of many may not be a necessary element for a strict definition of innovation.
or her very much doubt that Edison worked alone, and I think it was Watson and Crick. So N plus one may not necessarily be necessary or better in the days of we live on Wikipedia. It certainly seems that when you have many different minds contributing to a product, it's a better product. So I can boil that all down. I want to stipulate a definition of innovation as dynamic problem solving with friends. Now, why do we do it? Some for fame and glory, some for tenure. But usually I think there are three main reasons. First, it's a humanitarian imperative. We've got to deliver better for lives of people who are at risk and at stake. Not just one, not just ten. Tens of millions of people depend on the work of people in this room and will benefit from a better work created through the work of people in this room. Secondly, we need to do it because we need to do things, to use a phrase that's quite current now among funders in the humanitarian world, we need to show value for money. In order to sustain funding for our efforts, we need to show that we are doing the very best we can with what we are doing. And thirdly, in our organizations, innovation, I think, really helps corporate script. Staff like to belong to an organization that they think is moving forward and innovating. And they want to be able to contribute their creativity. I think they have a stake in moving the organization forward. I would not underestimate this element, the internal benefits of innovation in the organization as a whole. So one other way to say this is we do innovation for make it fast, things faster, cheaper, and happier. How do we do it? How do you get a stodgy, sclerotic UN organization, I won't mention any names, to think differently with friends? Let me give you just a few notes from the inside here as I've watched this over the last couple of years. First of all, it requires leadership. You need executive level support. And my boss, the high commissioner, said to me, go forth. I said to others, go forth, and they went forth. I have very solid results. But if it doesn't come from the top, it's not going to happen. Secondly, you need resources. I mean, these are things on the list here are going to be obvious to you, but I think it's just worth remembering them. We have benefited primarily from outside sources, very generous funding from Stephanie and Hunter Hunt, and from the IKEA Foundation, and from others. That has allowed us to have the startup funds to do the kind of work we do. And we know a lot of organizations, without money, we really are stunning. These are not, doesn't mean that just with money you can get innovation, but without it, it's really hard. Third, you need safe spaces and time. People in humanitarian organizations are incredibly busy. And you need a place to take them out, to give them some time to work. We've done this through the creation of a group of cadre people we call iFellows, who are people we've identified in the field to want to work on innovative work. We've gone to their supervisors and said, give them time, what is it, 10%, 20%, 20% of their time to do their innovation work, because without that set aside, you're just not going to get to these other ideas. We can't expect people to do these between the hours of midnight and 3 in the morning or on Saturdays and Sundays. Fourth, you need partners. You need the many minds. We've been blessed with incredible partners. I mentioned the IKEA Foundation, but also Stanford University, Oxford's Humanitarian Innovation Program here, UPS, UNICEF. So these are partners, academic, UN organizations, private sector, and foundations. Enormously important. Then you need to create inside your organization a sense of a support and fostering of innovation, not squashing. But what we discovered going out in UNHCR was that in virtually every one of our operations, we operate 100 people. I have not been one of our operations where people aren't doing really interesting and new things. They just don't tell headquarters about it. Because they're sure if they tell headquarters, it'll be squashed. And I can give you a couple of examples that I did. I had to catch myself from doing the squashing. So we were involved in a big biometrics program. I would do fingerprints or eye scans so that we know who people are and where they're traveling to. And our operation in Jordan wanted to do its own biometrics project and said, we can do it. We've got a way to let us go forward. And the response from headquarters was, no, we've got a global program we're going to put in place. You know, don't do it. And
They said, we need to, we were not moving fast enough, we said, go ahead. They have now registered over 750,000 people with biometrics. We are still in the process of choosing through the RFP the people we will work with on biometrics. Another example is what we call the Guichet Unique in Niger, a very creative representative of Niger who wanted to put together, with the help of SAP, right? a way of bringing refugees in and giving them sort of a one-stop shop. Window to get all their information. And people in headquarters like me said, wait a second, doesn't this get in the way of our registration system? We're now in the fourth iteration of our big registration system. Maybe we should slow it down. People said to me, no, you gotta let this go. And they were right. And now we've got a guichet unique about to start, and we are a year and a half behind in the fourth iteration of our registration system. So you've got to foster in the field that kind of work and not. You've got to check your headquarters impulses to say, slow down. Then you have to incentivize risk taking. And I think this is the hardest thing inside an organization. I'll give you another example from inside our organization. We have but we don't set our targets above what we set the year before. We are happy if we got last year's money, even though it tends to go up. Why? Because some people don't want to set a goal they think they might not reach, and they feel safer setting the goal they got last year than getting that money. That's not the way, I don't think you raise money that way. But how do you incentivize setting a higher goal to try to recycle? Another example, we just put in place an enterprise risk management system, just beginning to do this now. But as we talked to our field and headquarters folks about it, they said one of the responses came back saying, well, people aren't really going to identify the proper risks because they're worried those risks will happen, problems will happen, and they'll be blamed for not having taken mitigating measures to prevent the risk. It's that kind of inherent conservatism that doesn't really allow risk taking in an organization. So you have to think about strategies for incentivizing risk taking. One was this program I mentioned, the iFellows program, identifying people and saying, we want you to go out there and do interesting things. We've created awards, we have staff awards, and we've now created an award for innovation. We want to feature innovative people on the new innovation website. We've created challenges that go out to the field through new software, we call UNHCR ideas that lets our whole field contribute to coming up with better ideas to do certain things, like how do we teach education better, language better to children, and the winning one lends funded, so you can create those kind of incentives. You have to permit failure if you want to incentivize risk taking. Now, I think sometimes I remember my son when he was learning Suzuki violin was told to thank his mistakes by his teacher, which I think is why he's now got a saxophone. You have to be willing to accept failure. And our innovation unit has failed in a couple of interesting ways. On a trackpad program, we wanted to do a scanning, be able to scan goods when they were delivered, and we had a program worked out, but we tried it out, it didn't work, so we took it back and did more work on it, and now we're redeploying it with improvements. We sometimes say, I don't want to fail quick. I'm not sure I want to say it that way. I don't want to fail at all, but I would say this way, if you're going to fail, fail quick. Have procedures that allow you to say it didn't work, but you know, people think about some costs and some time. They'll keep going with stuff even when you know it's not going to make it. So you've got to let people fail, admit failure, and move on if you want to risk taking. And then you've got to make it cool. I'm afraid I have to do that to others, quite frankly. I do notice that Alex has named his program HIP, so I guess he's understood cool better than I have here. Anyway. Then I think you have to understand the process as horizontal. And networked and not vertical. That's the world you live in. It's this what we're seeing in front of us is a networked horizontal world. But even organizations are deeply hierarchical. And we have to find ways to eliminate that. We have organizations where some of you, these numbers will mean things, others not, but D1s won't talk to P4s. These are high-ranking directors. They just won't talk to them. They won't engage. And we've got to create vertical, non-vertical situations. All right, this is what we did inside, what insiders can do. The question then is, what's the outside? What's the outside goal?
Now let me say this to you quite frankly, over the room. It's more than simply generating a good idea. You have no idea how many good ideas come to you at ACR on a weekly basis. And we have very little time to analyze them, to adopt them, to move forward with them. When I was visiting Stanford and talking in class there, an innovator came up and he handed me a foldable cook stove that I took back with me in Geneva. At an event in Zurich, someone gave me a straw for filtering water. Now, these may be great things. They may be the next great thing. I don't have a way of dealing with that. And these are just two examples of dozens of ideas. And for those of us who write scholarly articles, we always think we've got the next great idea. Some of it only we didn't implement it. And it's just not the way the world works. Because we don't have the time to read, to structure these kinds of tests. And I think it's probably best to let us work from the inside out, or from the bottom up, as Alex described in his video here. I think it's better to organize ourselves in a way where we come forward with problems we're seeking to solve, and then engage you in working with us on solving those problems, rather than you trying to float your best new idea. It doesn't mean you're not having a great idea. I'm just telling you in terms of likelihood of success. It's just much less likely to get noticed. Now I see another role here, a really important role for academics and policy thinkers and activists in the field of science, just standing and waiting here. And I want to draw on a distinction here that writer Jill Lepore recently described in an article in the New Yorker. She drew a distinction between sustaining innovation and disruptive innovation. Now, sustaining innovation, I'll quote here from a recent article by Jack and Susie Welch. Jack Welch, you know, is a major American corporate leader who gives, I think, an account of sustaining innovation. He says, most people see innovation as a rare big bang. In reality, innovation is a series of little steps that lead up to a big deal that changes the game. So it might be the chip that holds more data, or the computer that runs faster, or these things don't challenge the reigning paradigm. Of course, within things, within a paradigm, do things faster and cheaper and better. Disruptive innovation is different. Disruptive innovation is the solar challenge to oil. It's the challenge email posed to the postal service. It's Amazon to the local bookshelf. Generally, disruptive innovation is cheaper. That's why people are interested in it. It relies on new technologies, and it catches established producers unaware, back on their heels, happy with their success. And in the end, it supplants them if it's successful. Now, insiders, if we practice innovation at all, we are generally of the sustaining innovation variety. We look for a more efficient cook stove, a better livelihood strategy. We want better monitor health needs and delivery. And attempts at disruptive innovation can be domesticated. So we had a plan for a new engagement, I call it an engagement hub in New York, that was going to combine communications and fundraising and really launch a new way to communicate with the American public. This was a disruptive idea, and it's now been reduced to sustaining innovation because I stepped on too many toes, and we're back to now thinking about how we can materially and slightly enhance our fundraising efforts in the U.S. Disruptive innovation inside an organization is, well, too disruptive. It makes too many enemies. It steps on too many toes or too much turf of others. And more important, it can be easily beaten by astute or bureaucratic players with vested interests. Like, we had an innovation consultant when we started off our innovation unit at UNACR. And the consultant was taken aside by a senior member of the management team at UNACR, who the consultant had not yet interviewed as he went around the building talking to people. And the person said, if you don't come talk to me and listen to me, I'm going to destroy this project. This is what I mean. It's not usually that blatant. But skilled bureaucrats can kill things by delay, or usually death by a thousand cuts. I could give more examples from inside UNHCR, but I won't. So when I go to our IHELPs, I met in meeting in Bangkok, and said to them, you are an insurgency inside UNHCR, an insurgency for cultural change. They blinked. They looked at me and said, like, what are you talking about? They don't want to be an insurgency. They want to get their P5s. Now, they don't want a badge of courage. people want to work inside the system and move up, even our innovators. So, if we want disruptive innovation, that's where you guys come in. You can be the force for or of disruptive innovation. You can be the paradigm breakers and shifters. You can be the one who help us see the box before we can think outside of the box. But frequently, academics, policymakers, activists in the humanitarian field tend towards sustained innovation and not disruptive innovation. I think this comes from desires to be relevant, to be a player, to have notice taken of your work. I say this with deep affection. I am a once and future academic, so I know what this game is about. But whatever the cause, it means that much of the scholarship and many of the suggestions are really about how can the humanitarian community do its job of assistance better. It's about sustaining innovation. There's actually one presentation I read that uses disruptive innovation in the title, although the description seems to be more on the sustaining side. If you're out there, come talk to me about this and tell me I'm wrong. But in any event, this is not bad, by the way. This is great work, the sustaining innovation work. It does help organizations move forward. But I hope we find some time for disruptive interventions. I hope we challenge the premises, the paradigms, the definition of problems. I hope we're willing to say, that's the wrong question you're asking. Here's the right question. And this leads me to my last point. Much of the innovation we talk about here, I'm talking about, is what I would call product innovation. Better stoves, better medical delivery, better livelihood. We need to think also about program innovation. And we need to think disruptive. So we should, instead of building clinics, should we give refugees medical insurance? Instead of giving people food and non-food items, should we be providing them the cash assistance instead, or the panel office? Instead of talking about three sustainable solutions of return, resettlement, or local immigration, should we talk about a fourth destabilizing solution of labor migration, giving people labor visas? These are potentially paradigm shifting kinds of interventions. Disruptive innovation has a chance, I think, of working if it is true to the goals of humanitarianism and it shows a better way to accomplish things. Because when we're saving lives, there should be no sacred cows. There should be no answer that that's not the way we do things here. In my part of the humanitarian world, which is about protecting and assisting displaced populations, I think we're ready for a disruptive paradigm shift. And I'll close on this thought. We have created, and many of us in this room have benefited from, establishing a regime, an industry, a culture of dependency, where humanitarian relief becomes long-term assistance. We know we don't move quickly enough from relief to development and reconstruction, except maybe in natural disaster situations. But when we have populations displaced by conflict, refugees and IDPs, humanitarian work stretches on for years, way beyond our original definition of humanitarian work. And that needs to change. And before we get on the road to long-term assistance, we need to think about avenues for self-reliance. A mix of humanitarian and development work, and perhaps significant private investment if the opportunities present themselves in development work. Now, this disruptive thought has both deep programmatic and product implications. And it will surely face the usual obstacles of innovation, entrenched interests, entrenched ways of thinking about creativity. But in the end, I think it's like the old joke about how many psychologists it takes to change a light bulb. The answer is one, but the light bulb really needs to want to change. Our humanitarian world, our organizations, must really want to change. We must become innovation ready by devoting resources, reaching down, reaching out for good ideas, and through clear statements from leadership. And we do this not to preserve our own relevancy or our market share, which perhaps is the motivation in the private sector. We do this because we deeply believe in the work that brings everyone in this room together to relieve suffering, to restore hope, and to promote robust human communities. Thank you.
the High Commissioner has kindly agreed to answer a couple of questions. So, if there are any questions, yes. And if you could introduce yourselves, that would be fantastic.
Hi, Sasha Chen of Refuge Point. Thank you. That was extraordinarily inspiring that you spoke to us at Refuge Point and everybody here. I had one question when Alex was speaking that perhaps you could answer. I wonder, we know that host countries play such a vital role in terms of enabling and allowing refugees to pursue their own strategies. Are there any strategies or ideas around acknowledging countries such as Uganda, acknowledging that country and its ability to enable refugees to support themselves so that we can see that happen in other countries?
Yeah, I think we've gotten much smarter about this, and this is where the development angle comes into our humanitarian work. We can't make significant progress on dependency unless we involve local communities. We have to think about development strategies that develop an entire area, not just do livelihood work for refugees. I think one of the problems is that we have thought about livelihoods. We've thought about how we teach a particular refugee a particular skill. And this is wrong for three reasons. One, we then never go out and see whether the refugee actually uses skills to produce income. So we have no evidence that any of these programs actually work. Some of you may have evidence, love to learn about. We don't comprehensively test the effectiveness of this work. Two, the focus is simply on the refugees, and that is the third. If you're going to have host communities involved in accepting refugees, you need to show there's a benefit for them as well, and that can come through development strategies, either from public development funds or perhaps from private investment. And I think this is the way that we are now moving through a set of something we call the solutions alliance, now some of our self-reliance work, but it has to go from the micro to the macro level. Not only are we going to get host community buy-in, but if we're actually going to make progress on creating self-reliance and resilience for hosting communities. I see Neil Green here from UNDP. He's been a partner with us in the work that we've done on trying to bring together humanitarian development. But this is something that really needs innovative thinking, because right now we do not have effective strategies for bringing development actors. We generally talk to governments and talk about long-term development plans, and humanitarian actors who get money from different pots and work with directly in the field through direct implementation or direct service themselves. And what we are looking for, and I invite someone here to write the article, is what I call the theory of the middle space, on how to bring these folks together, both in terms of conceptions and also in terms of funding strategies that may require governments to change the way they fund, or may require some massive investment from private sector. My goal here, Sasha, on this is, and I don't think this is a crazy idea, even as Sadi is roughly. We can live in a world where local communities compete for displaced populations if we do this right. Because you have a mobile, talented workforce entering an undeveloped area. That is the recipe. Just add dollars and serve, right? And it's a recipe for development that we should, if we do it right, we should be able to persuade countries it is actually in their interest to have refugees come. Now, most countries don't want to talk about it. They'll talk about the burden, but there's not burden now. There's some waiting for a World Bank report that might actually show a GDP increase because of the Syrian refugees in Lebanon. We generally talk about the huge burden, and it's clearly overburdened electric grids and schools and medical clinics and the like. But it's also brought new entrepreneurs, more demand and things, and so that's the kind of story we need to begin to tell, but we need ways of telling that. And the current humanitarian story does not tell that, because we talk about emergencies, we talk about international NGOs, local NGOs coming in and providing for refugees rather than refugees providing for themselves and the local communities in which they live.
Just one more question.
But I don't feel strongly about that.
Thanks. Brilliant opening address. I think it was really energizing for the next few days, so thanks to both you and Alex. You mentioned about being given the straw and the bubble looking stone and kind of what to do with it. And I guess one of the things that a number of people is missing in this humanitarian cycle is a place where we can put the different straws and water filters and stoves together and work out which of them are better. And I wonder what role do you see for organizations like UNHCR in intermediating innovation and working and structuring that process
of testing new approaches? I can imagine two ways, at least two. One is, again, to work from the inside out. So if we know that a major problem is clean water, we can go out with a challenge to all of you and say, hey, here are 10 different places, 10 different kinds of situations, we have real issues with water. what's out, we can pull in examples, and people can then we can analyze what we've got. The second is for there to be a public-private clearing house on this. You guys should be organizing yourself and doing the screening that we can't do. And say there are, we put together, there's a Cookstone Alliance out there that's been out here for 4 or 5 years, which is worked to some extent in the private sector. I mean, people list their cookstoves and people can buy them and there was, but it has not penetrated the humanitarian world yet. Maybe we can think about an outside process that can do this work for us. And the third, this is my big idea, I haven't found any support for yet, but I'm an optimistic person. We need to create an Institute for Humanitarian Science somewhere, maybe Oxford, maybe Stanford, that would bring together policy people, scientists, for a year or so, a real kind of set of problems that are given to them. Here's the minds of women coming together on defined topics. And we don't do that, a lot of us work kind of scattered ways or something. But if we could say, here are the big scientific humanitarian problems that we solve, clean water, cookstoves, whatever you want to come up with, or analyze the effectiveness of cash-based interventions. If we could pull together, like Stanford does with their Center for Advanced Studies, and Princeton has a similar one, Oxford has similar kinds of interventions here, bring a bunch of scholars in here, give them a set of problems, have them work it out, we would all benefit from something like that. So those are these three different ideas for how we might do it.
Alex, thank you for such an inspirational start. Directly into our opening plenary panel session. I'd like to invite the four panelists to come up. As they're doing so, I just want to give some introduction and context. Building directly on Alex Aleinikoff's keynote address, we decided to open up with a plenary panel on humanitarian innovation and the United Nations. In a sense, the United Nations doesn't seem the obvious place to go for inspiration about innovation. It's not traditionally been known as the most innovative set of organizations in the world. But of course, as the Deputy High Commissioner's opening address has acknowledged, that is beginning to change. And it's beginning to change across a number of organizations, beginning with UNICEF's very pioneering work in developing innovation labs and an innovation unit. Other organizations across the UN system have started to develop innovation projects, innovation programs, and to mainstream the idea across their work. On this panel, we've brought together representatives from four of the most pioneering humanitarian organizations in the UN system in this regard: UNICEF, UNHCR, OCHA, and WFP. And we're privileged to have four of the people who are really leading that work within those organizations, who are able to speak to the challenges that they face within the organization, looking outside the organization, partners and collaborators in ways that Alex described, here today with us to share those experiences. The four speakers we have are Stuart Campo from UNICEF, who is roaming the innovation lead as part of the UNICEF Innovation Unit. That means he gets to go across countries, work in country in a variety of situations, and provide support to UNICEF's vast range of innovation labs around the world. From OCHA, we have Leslie Bournes, who's Humanitarian Affairs Officer, and who's working very significantly on developing their innovation work within the organization, but also trying to convene and help collaboration across UN organizations as part of OCHA's work, but also as part of the World Humanitarian Summit. We're joined by Annalisa Conte from the World Food Programme, who's Deputy Director of their Policy, Programme and Innovations Division, in which he's Chief of the Innovation Service. And we're joined, last but definitely not least, by Olivia Delahoud, who is co-lead of UNHCR Innovation, and together with his colleagues working under Alex Aleinikoff, has really pioneered innovation within the organization, at headquarters, and increasingly at the field level. So we're really thrilled to have all four of you. The hope is that this will be an informal, very relaxed dialogue. We'll open up by giving each of the four speakers a chance to say what they're doing in this area of humanitarian innovation. And then we'll have a backwards and forwards and conversation and dialogue. And then we'll open up the audience so that we can
get some more questions, explore how you as organisations can continue the excellent work you're doing, but perhaps we can think about how to work more broadly and include the many people in the audience here today. So perhaps we could begin, Stuart, with you, and you could tell us a bit about UNICEF, partly because UNICEF is in many ways the first mover within the United Nations in trying to embrace innovation.
Great. Everyone hear me? So I think, Alex, you mentioned two of the most important things for UNICEF innovation, which are our unit, which is out of New York, and our headquarters in the office of the executive director, and our network of labs. And this structure really brings together the country-level work we do in 135 countries with our 12,000 staff, and the sort of high-level policy and advocacy work we do out of New York around innovation. Right now, we have a network of 16 labs spanning from San Francisco to Indonesia to South Sudan. And those labs focus on different thematic areas, depending on context. It's important to note that our innovation work is very much program-driven. That's not always easy. So we get excited about technology and new solutions and then try to retrofit to challenges we see in the field. But more and more we're defining a process for programmatic innovation. I was glad to hear that the High Commissioner mentioned that as a priority to more programmatic innovation and how we do that. So through our labs, which are physical spaces that focus on things from fabrication to software development to process design and young people and decision makers, we're redefining the way that UNICEF and our partners think about the key challenges we face. So I can speak sort of throughout this panel about what we do with the labs, but maybe that's sufficient for you.
Amazing. Perhaps you can tell us about what you're doing at the World Food Program.
Yes. Well, at the World Food Program, perhaps we have a set up that is a little bit different, because I would say that innovation has been or is part of the DNA of our staff, perhaps for necessity, in order to be able to reach the beneficiaries. In a certain way, because of this approach, we could consider that each of our country offices is a kind of lab. Maybe some of them are much more advanced than others. But definitely, innovation is really happening in the field. And then it is the role of our regional bureaus within the region to play the role of accelerator. And then it is the role of headquarters to make it much more institutional and part of the organizational setup. So to identify those innovations that they are really worthwhile to be pursued. But as the Deputy Commissioner was saying, sometimes it is difficult to fit the innovations that are happening, because sometimes they are hidden, you know, they want to solve a problem and they don't want to tell it to headquarters, otherwise we might stop them.
Hi. The first element of this is we commission that as in WFP, our staff are innovators by necessity. They have to adapt to very difficult and oftentimes dangerous situations, providing protection and relief to refugees. So this is the first recognition that our staff are innovating, but also the refugees are innovating. And we, because of lack of technology, have not put together the tools to actually listen to capture their ingenuity, to capture the solution they have actually come up with, to deal with their own situation. And UNHCR innovation has been established under the leadership of Alex and the High Commissioner under their umbrella to actually do three main things, which is capturing the innovation happening inside and outside the organization. It's rewarding innovation within the organization and fostering this innovation. And we do that by establishing five pillars. We have a place called the labs. Those are thematic labs. We have four labs right now, looking at energy, looking at connectivity, data, looking at shelter, home settlement, and about ICT and education. And FIF Lab has been integrated into the division dealing with the self-reliance. And these labs are a safe place to innovate. Alex was talking about quick failure. It is important to have this place where incubation can happen, where the exchange with the private sector, academic sector, the NGOs, you guys, can actually foster new solutions that are solution fits for purpose, that are bottom-up approach, that are human-centered design, designed at the first place, the people in mind. And we have established also a system, and Stephanie Hunt has been a huge supporter of, is what we call, Alex was referring to, UNHGIDs. It's a system that actually, through a web platform, enables refugees, UNHCR staff, partners, NGOs, government officials, to participate in the definition of the solution, to unleashing the ingenuity of our staff and partners. And this is something absolutely critical, because until now, with the lack of technology, we did not have these tools. Now we have that. The third pillar is our innovation fund. It's a small fund that has been established to accompany this development of the solution. And this is quite fundamental, because without the money, it's really difficult to prototype, to iterate, to test, and then actually to scale. The fourth pillar is, Alex was mentioning, our innovation fellowship. It's a group of 20 individuals that we have selected that are diverse, from diverse backgrounds, that are actually the pioneering of innovation. The guys who are really carrying innovation at their field level. And the last one is all our social media engagement. It's about communicating, it's about celebrating innovation, celebrating failure, celebrating this change is happening in the organization. Alex was referring to, you know, startups really excited about it because they feel proud, they feel empowered. And that's the function of UNHCR innovation, unleashing the full potential of staff and refugees.
I think we're in your sort of conversation, some of our colleagues, so there's things that we can learn about how you institutionalize some of this and sort of at the top, at the field level. But I think for OSHA, we're looking at it from two tracks. So I'm in the policy section, and there we're kind of thinking about how do we make a case for innovation and why we need it on a big picture scale. So looking at some kind of systems level challenges around urban response, around access to people in need and conflict. Things that are really changing the operational environment, and how can innovation help us to address some of those things. And then the other track is more operational for us as an agency. So part of our mandate is around communication and information sharing. And so we've developed some tools like humanitarian kiosks and other things that help us to do that job and also to kind of integrate technology more for our work. And then we've done some smaller things as an experiment. So we've done a research and innovation grant program, which is a small grant for research around innovative solutions to problems. And so that's one way that we see kind of what we're doing out there by looking at those applications. We got people from, I think, 25 countries ready to us with an idea of the projects that we wanted to do. So we're still finding our way, but that's how we were thinking about it.
It's very amazing how much has transformed just over the last couple of years in all the organizations across the sector. One of the challenges that I keep seeing is that there's still debate over terminology about what we actually mean by innovation. And the Deputy High Commissioner gave us this definition I really quite like of dynamic problem solving with friends. But I think many of us are still using the language to mean a variety of different things. So I'm sort of intrigued to know how you understand the very idea of innovation.
So, for us, it's really about either, as I said, a disrupting innovation, something that is totally new, that has not been done before, that is coming because of the partnership with the private sector and the academic sector, the NGO sector, where all together we are bringing this new element to create something new. That's the first first one. The second one is actually incremental change. Small changes, iteration of something that's actually working, that can work better. And that's the definition that we feel, because you don't stop innovating. Innovation is about a continuous improvement of a situation. The technology is evolving very rapidly. Environments are changing rapidly. UNHCR is facing increased urbanization of the refugee protection context. How do we adapt to this reality? How do we embrace this connection between the host community and the refugees and the partners? To mesh this, you need to have a process and methodology. And for us, innovation is about this human-centered design methodology, this methodology of putting the people at the very center of what we're trying to achieve with and for them. And it's also about the methodology. It has to start from the field. It's a field challenge based that we're trying to address with and for the people. And then you have the methodology of prototyping, testing, iterating, and scaling. And the scaling is complicated. It's actually one of the most challenging aspect of innovation. It's great to have a small solution, but you need to actually broadcast that to the entire organization. We're working in 125 countries, so you can see the challenges we face. But that's the challenge, where we rely on government friends, and I see some of them here, to actually help us drive this innovation across the organization in order to reach out to the maximum people at the time.
How does this understanding with other experts and other organizations relate to that, that broad understanding of innovation and performance of your piece work, or that differences in the nature of your work because it's about maybe emergency food delivery and innovation like that?
No, I think that broadly we could find very many similarities. I would like to stress, however, the component that innovation is first and foremost for the people that we are assisting, to offer them appropriate solutions to the problem of food insecurity and hunger. And then, of course, with the changes that we are seeing outside there, economic changes, technologies, the market. Of course, we have to introduce programmatic innovations in order to maintain our role and our operation effective. Innovation is critical to the effectiveness of our intervention. This being said, we have also a number of innovations in order to make our operations more cost efficient, and in order also to facilitate the work of the humanitarian partners, particularly within those clusters that are led by WFP. Innovation is important, not only for us, but for the entire community of partners that are part of that cluster.
OCHA is obviously trying to play a collaborative role in creating a common dialogue, creating a common language. Are you seeing consensus around what innovation needs starting to emerge, let's say, or are people still working on different missions?
Well, I think I see more agreement outside across agencies than I do within OCHA, and I think that's maybe where we're working more on kind of having a shared definition of what it means. I don't know if others find that, but I think we've adopted a pretty simple definition that it's innovation is a process, and for one thing, just getting that idea across is already a step for adaptation and change. And I think one key element of it is that it's not incidental. It's not just about a good idea, as was mentioned in the keynote. It has to be deliberate and supported by a system. So there are lots of good ideas out there. What do we need to do to bring those ideas out and support them and make it safe to talk about them? And also, I think we thought about what does innovation as a mindset help us to do that we need to do on other issues in other parts of the system. So it's collaborative by definition, and that's something that we need to be more in the humanitarian system, more collaborative and work together more. It's forward-looking for us, and I think that's a critical piece. It's not just looking back at
what our last evaluation calls about what we did last year, but what's coming in the next 5 or 10 years and how do we prepare for that. So I think some of the things that come along with the innovation mindset help us think about more broadly about the system and those changes.
I think it's something we explore in this brain how you experience barriers within the organization, within the particular organization you work with. To what extent do you face skepticism, doubt? To what extent do you have to know particular parts of the organization in order to do your work? Stuart, I mean, as somebody who's in an organization has relatively long experience of trying to engage with innovation, having expanded from a small number of people in New York to developing labs around the world, what do you experience as the big organizational barriers and challenges in the culture of the organization?
Sure. I think there are probably two. One is behavioral or attitudinal, and the other is structural. The behavioral one is fear, right? Fear to take risks, fear to invest critical resources in anything that might not be delivering impacts for children. And fear to be the first one, whether that's an individual or an office, to say, I'm going to try it soon. So that, I mean, it's a labor of love. Certainly getting around that fear, driving through that fear, but that's what our labs serve to do, and that's what the different levels of the organization within and outside of our team do now is create space. Alex mentioned safe space for innovation, safe space for new ideas, and that's really, that's essential, and that's outside of all of our organizations as well. It's that collaborative dialogue that we have, where we say, and what the donors say, and what our partners say, we've been doing what we're doing for a while, and it's not all working, right? So we can be scared of doing something different, but we can't really be proud of doing everything the same. So we need to drive through two new solutions. Aside from the fear, there's the bureaucracy. The elephant in the room. Structures do not always allow us to be agile, right? We have principles, and we have ways of doing things, and we understand quite well now, I think, how to promote innovation in humanitarian and development contexts, but how to actually execute and implement is the difficult part. Our structures are not built to allow for sort of quick and dirty programming, we know that, and that's where our civil society partners are essential. Our structures also are a bit confused when new bits and bobs enter the orbit, right? So we might try to procure a new device that has never been procured before. 7 months later, we're back to the IBM product that we use in every office, and that makes it difficult to program. There's a give and take, I think, between structural requirements, we are a nation that's comes with some weight and responsibility, but there's also this need to take ourselves less seriously and let our structures not get in the way of delivering results for the entire community.
Yeah, I suppose you want that being my mission to mention that in traditionally hierarchical organizations, it's difficult to embrace the horizontality of country working relationships to ensure that people can collaborate with organizations that are often quite directed. So what extent have you been able to overcome those challenges in your work?
The second element in the room is the side, we all work in the side, which is like a human nature tendency. Either within organizations, but across organizations. We do not work collaboratively. And also about how do you mesh the private sector academic work into the work of UNHCR or the humanitarian world. Because we do operate in silos, we have to break this. And one of the key elements for us has been the establishment of the labs. And it's, as Alex said, a safe place where we can incubate, where all these parties can come to the park and deliver something. And it's also about recognizing that ideas are emerging on the ground, but we don't necessarily have the tools to capture that. That's where we provided this UNHCR platform that actually is providing this very hierarchical platform. Anybody can collaborate. Be the High Commissioner to anybody in the field, and the refugees, and those communities, to contribute to a solution. This is really through the power of technology. We're able to do that today. Before it was too costly. It was not realistic. We are hoping to do it, but we did not manage. We have just done it. And it's also about, you know, we talked about bias earlier. We should not be taken for granted. It's actually hard work. You know, we're portraying kind of a nice picture of innovation, embracing innovation. But actually, there's a lot of resistance to innovation because it's turfing on a territory that people actually are in charge of. And who are you to challenge me? So our definition is also about facilitating. If you're doing innovation already, that's great. Continue, because actually it's a key function of your own department is to innovate, to iterate, to improve the quality of your work for the refugees. But if you are stuck, we need to unstuck you. And that's kind of the goal of UNHCR innovation. Wherever this really wicked problems are, we're here to solve with a bit of money, a methodology, and a safe place to work. And that's breaking the cycle, breaking this attitude of isolation, and we bring the collaboration element.
In there are silos within organizations, but I'm also wondering about silos between organizations. I mean, one of the remarks that Deputy Commissioner made that struck me was one of the imperatives for innovation is to get value for money. And that's partly in the context of increasing competition between organizations. And innovation can be useful because it can support rebranding and that can support partnerships. How do you balance cooperation, collaboration, crossing between organizations with the nature of the humanitarian business? Leslie, at Oxford, you're trying, I suppose, to bring your organizations together to improve collaboration. To what extent is that proving possible in this area? How easy is it to get different organizations together to work on innovation as a collective project?
Well, I think in part, you know, one of the best initiatives for doing that was spearheaded by UNHCR to establish this UN Innovation Network to bring different agencies who are doing this work in some form, even if they don't have a kind of, you know, lab or section that they call innovation to talk about how it's working. And I think it's outside of the UN. It's not a UN initiative. It's not within any UN structures. And I think that's one of the real kind of merits of it in a way. We all kind of take our hats off at the door and sit down at the table and talk about what we're doing. And so I think that's one of the realities of being able to collaborate, that we need to take things in some extent outside of spaces like this to have those conversations. I think, you know, people are at different stages of knowledge of the process. So at least from my perspective at OSHA, I think we know we have a lot to learn in some areas from others. You know, we need more investment in a policy space where others haven't had an opportunity to do a study of a certain kind. So I think in a way there's kind of a mapping of our own about different capacities and how those relate. Some competition is good and normal, and I think that's probably part of what we want. But I do think at the working level, we all kind of overcome a lot of that.
And in terms of that initiative led by UNHCR and the new what stage is that collaborative initiative at? What are the challenges you face?
So I'm the co-leader of this UN Innovation Network with Chris Stevian, the co-leader of the Business Innovation and Erica Kochi. And together we are putting this big organization, nine organizations, UNICEF, UNHCR, WFP, UNDP, OCHA, UIDO, Global Pulse, and UNFPA. That's open network, so we'll be joined by other organizations. But we want to start small, and we want to offer this opportunity in a very unpoliticized, unhierarchical, and organized organization point of view to quite move this innovation agenda forward across our agencies, to look at similarities, to look at potential synergies. We don't want to reinvent the wheel, and we do that a lot across the sector. Humanitarian work, as we invented the wheel many times, wasting a lot of money. We're here to actually try to do that differently in order to avoid this phenomenon. It's also about us not working in isolation, the UN. We're here to be totally collaborative. And we're trying to work with, eventually, organizing ourselves to work with the Federation of Red Cross Group and ICRC, the NGO network, the private sector, the academic sector, and offering this platform of collaboration that is not happening today. It's complicated, and we need to manage this properly. And I think if we do that properly, the world will see the UN as actually what it is, a facilitator, an empowering organization that is reaching out to millions, billions of people. We have the scale in the UN. We may not be the most effective, we may be bureaucratic, but actually we have the mandate to tackle big, big issues. And that's kind of what this network is about. In a very humble and starting way, we just established in November, and the UN Foundation has been a key supporter of the IKEA Foundation in setting up this network. And this is where, again, the role of the private sector, we don't work in isolation, we work as collaborative effort.
Let's think about that theme of reaching out to the millions of people, because a number of you mentioned when we discussed how we think about innovation, the idea of the affected populations, the end users, user-centered design being really a central part of this. One of the challenges traditionally in sector is how it engages so-called affected communities, how it makes them part of the solution as well as part of the problem specification. And Alisa, perhaps you could tell us something about the way in which WFP thinks about the role of affected communities in this event.
Yeah. I think that particularly in recent years, when WFP has moved from food aid to food assistance, this has opened for our organization really many more opportunities to further engage with the affected communities. And I think that later today, in the afternoon, we will have also a presentation as part of the panel on partnership, where we will be able to present concrete examples of how we have been so far trying to engage with the affected communities. It is really a critical element if we want to deliver a sustainable solution to their problem. They have to be part of the solution. They have to be part of how to tackle their food insecurity in our case. And over the past few years, we have really tried to use several channels to make beneficiaries to become an active partner in the design and in the implementation of our operations. I'm not saying that we have reached perfection, not at all. We are really at the very early stage. But we are at the very at the early stage of a process where we would like to see programs becoming much more beneficiary driven. And so much more bottom-up approach rather than a top-down approach.
And if you just said in innovation work, does that polarize you? Some of it is quite tech-focused, some of it is very, very community-engaged. Could you perhaps give us a flavor for some of the examples of UNICEF's work that engages directly with communities?
Sure. I think the user-centered design element is probably the most important principle of what we do. And Olivia also mentioned the importance of humility. I think that's really why we try to put children, other members of the children's network, at the middle of what we do, because they know better than we do. So we have both solutions that are built around and with users, and then solutions that help us learn more from and engage with users. So maybe we start with the second group. There's a platform that we developed in Uganda that's now active in many countries called eReport. It's probably one of the better known UNICEF innovations. It's quite simple. It uses SMS technology for now, soon other channels, to engage young people in policy, advocacy, and decision making. And when it evolves in Uganda, where there are almost 300,000 young people across the country using the system, it serves as the primary source of information for decision makers about what's going on at level for young people. So we're really driving eReport through an initiative called Giving Voice to Demand. Right? We're really trying to engage communities, primarily young people, but also other decision makers at the community level, in this technology and trying to make this core service so a new normal, as it were, no longer an innovation, but a platform that grew out of the innovation and has become business as usual. And we're rolling this out primarily in Eastern and Southern Africa for now, but it is active in Indonesia, and Chile is looking at the system, so we're getting some traction. So having access to communities is obviously essential to doing user-centered design. Olivia mentioned that it's very expensive, obviously, to engage face-to-face on a regular and a meaningful way with the communities affected, so we have to have these tools in place. In terms of actual user-centered programs that have been built with end users, one of the most exciting and most recent interventions is Program 11, led by our lab there, with the population in the camps using Raspberry Pi technology. I don't know how many people know a Raspberry Pi. It's good. So computing hardware, learning how computers work, and an open source platform called Khan Academy Lite. People have probably heard of Khan Academy, open education resources. So we've put this platform on Raspberry Pi technology with some cheap ruggedized screens and let them loose in the community. And children are learning how to access content, how to actually code and use the technology, and the affected population is now helping evolve that product to a level where we can bring it to scale.
Well, that'd be very interesting perspective, and but given that the commissioner again mentioned the importance of self-reliance, the importance of user-centered design, could you give us some examples of how you and someone else could really try to find the approach?
So as Alex said, this element of self-reliance, providing the tools for people to be more empowered to take care of themselves during the uprooting events is essential. And it's really the DNA, if you look at the sum of what we're doing, it's really this, the self-reliance, because it's linked to dignity. It's linked to this aspect of giving the tools for people to take care of themselves. So it's right to say that, but actually in a refugee context, being urban or in encampment situation, in settlement situation, it's a high context. And in working with our division dealing with livelihood, we are piloting some projects that are actually giving these essential tools in an uprooted population. For instance, we're working with what we call data outsourcing, providing work over the internet, over the cloud, to refugees. The micro work that you can do online now, and you can get payment through, especially in Kenya, M-Pesa, or mobile money. That's a revolution that we are trying to harness. We are looking also at the reverse supply chain, looking at how in a community could provide for their own needs by producing the goods in country, in the refugee camp, with the host community, and looking also at the sector of demand and supply to see how can this be done in a camp, at the camp level, regional or national, where you can produce goods that could be exported outside of camps, could be exported actually internationally. So providing this opportunity for a reliable source of income, that's really the complication in an uprooting situation. That's what Humanitarian Innovation and our colleagues are trying to achieve.
I'm sure there are going to be lots of questions to pick up on any of these themes, but I've just got one last theme that I've used in all of your stories, which is a lot's being made of the fact that the United Nations faces real challenges. It's no longer just a humanitarian system dominated by a small number of organizations, but we really have a humanitarian ecosystem that NGOs, businesses, community-based organizations, faith-based organizations are filling up that gap, and that the UN perhaps needs to adapt and can't just do business as usual. I'm interested to sort of hear from each of you, what is the future of the United Nations in the humanitarian sector? As organizations, as a system, where should that system go? Leslie is this organization charged with part of that coordination, very involved with the World Humanitarian Summit. What do you think the future looks like?
I mean, I think there are a couple of things. One, since you mentioned your opening section, and people have also talked about it, just
that the role of the UN, at least from the developer's perspective, is really defined by the context. So in some cases, maybe it play a more significant role if there's less government capacity or in a place where people are in need of additional protection, or we may play a very small and marginal role as a facilitator or worker. And that we need to not just kind of have our toolbox that we go and arrive in a country and open up, but think more about what the context needs, and particularly for OCHA, what coordination is needed and what role we play as a facilitator. And I think the other thing, just more generally for the humanitarian system, is moving from a response kind of mentality to more of a risk and preparedness. And this is a conversation that's gone on for a long time, but now we're in a moment where the scale of crisis and the frequency of crisis really means that we need to step back and think about how, we just don't have the capacity to continue to respond to everything. So how do we think about what are the risks that we know are coming? We have great information now. We have a lot of data about what the risks are in a given context. How do we align funding and planning and coordination to those risks rather than just something happens in the
This is a big question. In my opinion, this is about us being more organized and facilitating the development of solutions, making sure that ideas that are happening in that part of the world could actually be relevant in this part of the world, actually are known, which is not the case. And again, this is a big challenge. How do you? There's so much going on in this world. How actually you make sense? How do you provide clarity, specificity, not only from an engagement perspective, but actually from a solution design perspective? I think the UN is a place, and the IKEA Foundation is a huge supporter of the UN, UNHCR, UNDP, and UNICEF. And they often say, you guys have the scale. If we were to do that with many actors, it will actually not be cost effective. So our responsibility is to embrace this, but also working with partners, opening to the private sector, to really have this collaboration effort at the fore. And I think that is going to be a transformative agenda, where we will be not seen as this bureaucratic, closed organization as a whole, but a very open, dynamic, agile organization that is there to facilitate the development of solutions for the many.
Well, if we look at the present big humanitarian emergencies, like the South Sudan or the Central African Republic, one could be a little bit misled and think that things haven't changed so much, because in those contexts, we are providing an assistance, and the way in which we are providing assistance is very much similar to what we did in the past. But actually, the world is changing. Actually, we should prepare ourselves for new challenges, but also a new role. If we consider that there is an increasing number of countries that in the next few years, they will be middle-income countries, where governments will be able to play a much more active role. And therefore, the UN system, to be relevant, we will have still to be able to support those governments, but definitely not being in the typical driving seat in which exactly we arrive with our toolbox, we open it, and here is the way to do it, but really being led by the governments, and being led also by what beneficiaries want to do it, and how they want to solve the problem.
So I think it really touches back to the scale and also what makes us what makes us different is, several of the other panelists have described, our ability to cross-pollinate, our ability to stimulate innovation and creativity, new ideas, but also our ability to hold ourselves accountable in contexts where others may not be able to. I think as the wicked problems get more complex, and unfortunately seem to be doing so, we need to step back and perhaps look at getting back to basics as agencies and with our partners. I worked recently in South Sudan prior to joining the team in this capacity, and there's a bit of a frenetic nature of the humanitarian a lot of people do it. And I think that one thing we're in a position to do and to learn more about is how to rediscover or perhaps discover in new ways what it is we're best at as agencies, what it is our partners are best at in terms of delivery of services, and what it is that we can do across countries and emergencies to leverage the power of the United Nations. If we're not doing that, we're not being responsible. So I think holding ourselves responsible to realizing what it is that we're meant to be doing as this funky, clunky organization will allow us to deliver better things.
So what I hear is a United Nations system reaching outwards for collaboration, cross-fertilization, cross-pollination, sharing of ideas. So it seems like a good opportunity to bring you into this discussion and to offer you the opportunity to engage with four of the people who, from their organizations, are at the cutting edge of these themes. So the floor is open. If you have a question or comment to direct a particular speaker, please make that very clear. This is a general open. That's also absolutely fine. If you could introduce yourself, that would be great.
Thank you. My name is Hal Rush, and I work at the Center for Research in Innovation Management. Right. As an academic who's worked in this field for 30 years, it's really encouraging to see the diversity of approaches that different agencies within the UN system have been taking towards exploring the innovation spaces. I hope, maybe too early at this point in time, but I hope that together you will also be not just sharing what you're doing, but also evaluating which organizational approaches work better or worse in different organizational contexts. However, having also seen in different sectors approaches of large agencies, large organizations attempting to introduce innovation into their organization in order to achieve the missions that they have, there is a debate that academics at least are interested in and aware of about the dangers of setting up what is internal silos for innovation. That when you walk into an organization and you ask them about innovation, they say, oh, we don't do that, they do that over there. That's their responsibility. I presume this is an issue that has been discussed internally within your organizations and is recognized as such. And I'd like to know your perspective on it in terms of this dichotomy, perhaps it's too extreme to actually call it that, between setting up those individual spaces, because they're safe, as was described, as a location for innovation, as opposed to imbuing it throughout and making it part of the organizational culture. That's what something that we actually do and we have responsibility for.
So in a way, two questions. The first thing about the paradox of the innovation space, does it create silos and exclude? And the second one you started with, to what extent are you able to engage the culture of evaluating and engaging in M&E to look at what innovation does? So who's going to be doing the
reverse? Perhaps I can try
to.
If innovation is very well set up, let's say in an organization with a proper apparatus, yes, one can run the risk of making innovation one side of the house and everything else is happening in the other side. If you make it much less formal, you may risk not to have a sufficient collaboration and internal cross-fertilization and ideas going all over the place. I think that there isn't the perfect recipe. What is really important it is to be led by clear objectives and clear results in terms of innovations. Why are we doing innovation? Is it because it is a fancy word? It is because we like, or there is a group of people that are in the morning, they like to have new ideas, different ideas, or are we really driven by making ourselves relevant to what are the challenges of the world today, and also with a future perspective. What is going to be the world that in 10, 15, or 20 years? Is the world still needing us? If we think so, how do we have to shape ourselves in order to meet the expectations? So I think that there isn't the magic formula, but definitely one should avoid creating the silos and at the same time also avoiding to have just a dissemination of ideas all over the places.
So when you set up your innovation lab, your innovation unit or structure, how do you mainstream the culture of innovation across the village? How do you involve people?
So in our experience, I mean, there are perhaps two approaches that we've several that the presence of principles really helps, and the articulation of a set of principles that don't actually look that new or different, but do have value, help the broader organization understand and demystify, right? So a set of principles against which our country office colleagues and people in headquarters who are not inside the innovation unit can start to understand what it is that this weird group of people does and what we're encouraging them to be a part of has been helpful. And in our new strategic plan, there are four indicators on innovation that are quite broad and not attached to the presence of a lab or an innovation person in your country. So we're really trying to promote our eventual redundancy, as it were. And in that regard, the other thing we've done is kept our budget very small as a unit. So Chris will talk about the fact that he rarely has more than $50,000 in bank at any given time. We fund programmatic innovation through our programs. So we drive investment from program colleagues, even if we do take a leading role in getting the ball rolling, designing solutions with them, and periodically implementation, we make sure that they're investing. Because for better or for worse, we know that that's a good way of making attention when there's money. So I think keeping it light on its feet, both financially and structurally, is one way to avoid this complex problem, but it's definitely an issue. And there's probably not been enough thought, academic or practical, within the UN around whether we're doing this effectively. And maybe that sort of starts to look at the second question around evaluating. We should evaluate our interventions and also our process.
And on the evaluation, this is absolutely central. We need to reflect on what we do in order to ourselves iterate, ourselves improve the way we do business. So a good example, I think, is on this UNHCR. We asked actually Alex's team to be live in the platform and to monitor in real time the behavior of participants, giving us guidance on how to improve the platform. And Luis has been absolutely central to do this exercise. And for us, learning from our own tools, people to make it more relevant, effective. So that's also the humility. We are not perfect. We need to improve. And we have to apply the principle of innovation to ourselves also. And the last one is about management. Management of innovation is essential. Innovation does not happen naturally. If it was, it will be there. But sometimes it's not, because it's complex. And one of the issues, one of the barriers, is the budget rigidity. You need to have a place where you can unstuck people by providing them funds for prototyping. Because in a regular budget, especially in the UN, risking money into an R&D project is highly complex. And this is where we need to have this flexibility for the organization, across the organization. And this is also where the private sector comes in. The Care Foundation has supported a project called Refugee Housing Unit, providing the key R&D, more than $6 million over the last 4 years. Without this money, we will not have succeeded in achieving this last prototype that is going to be produced now in the next year or so. So that's kind of flexibility. You need to have a structure where we can organize this conversation across for the benefit of the organization and the refugees.
Let's take another question. There's a lady who mentioned raising the
Hi, I'm Kristen Sonic. I'm a 301 Innovation Center Research and Study. This is a very dull question about procurement. So compared to previous renewal efforts of humanitarian enterprise, human rights-based approaches and humanitarian reform comes to mind. There's very little talk about accountability and transparency when we talk about innovation. In fact, here today, procurement rules, which have been adopted to enhance accountability and transparency, have been explicitly mentioned as impediments to innovation. You know, a lot of innovation is more than just getting stuff or delivering objects. I understand that. But I'd be very interested in hearing your views on the procurement angle. Obviously, I have a lot of yes. It seems like we're not talking enough about procurement. It gets almost zero attention in academia.
And people groan and sigh when they hear the word procurement, but it's amazing how central it is to the functioning of the humanitarian system. I know Osha's beginning to think about the idea in relation to logistics questions like procurement. So maybe Leslie, you'd like to.
I guess I would say I think about it more in terms of the limitations on partnership, and this is sort of a form of contracting procurement and thinking about who we work with. That's a real barrier to being able to do something quickly and being able to do something with an unusual partner. Major barrier to private sector partnerships for us in the community secretariat. And there are some good reasons why there are those kind of protections that go all the way back into GA resolutions. But I think if we want to move with the system, we have to address some of those barriers. So it may not be covered in a lot in academia, but we talk quite a lot about it, I think, across agencies and are trying to think about how we can concretely address that. So it is a live conversation.
UNHCR is looking at some really creative ways to address procurement.
Yes. Look, innovation will not happen without this flexibility around innovation or innovation around procurement, because our own rules are set for basic reasons. But they are the biggest barriers of sometimes moving ahead. So we have to go sometimes outside the UN procurement to acquire a piece of software, for instance, UNHCRIDs, because within our own rules, we have been too complex to do it. But the organization has actually responded positively to this attitude, say, yes, we understand our own constraint for procurement, and we are actually allowing you to do so because eventually this will become mainstream to a regular procurement process. And also, we always talk about procurement, the bad guys, they're actually very keen to help ourselves to be better, to harness the power of partnership. When you do an R&D project, it's really not a strict procurement process in a whole sense. It's actually meshing various elements to provide a better solution to the people, affected population. That's a new way of thinking. And our guys in the procurement department are really keen to explore these avenues, understanding the constraints and the barriers that are today, but trying to move this forward. Because, as you said, it's absolutely central to our ability to deliver.
Question from the balcony.
Josh Lyons with Human Rights Watch. Previously, I spent a good part of the last decade working in the UN doing satellite-based applications for humanitarian work. And there's a lot I want to say about the role of bureaucracy and interagency libraries as an impediment to innovation writ large. But I just keep it positive for the moment. And then maybe just an observation, a casual observation, and an appeal. The casual observation, I think we, within the UN system, we have cycles where we bring in a lot of people, and I'm saying all of these tech people are coming in, all of these innovative people are coming in, and they go out. And there's no ability to capture those lessons learned. There's no mechanism by which we really have a sort of institutionalized memory to keep track of all of the previous innovative experiences. So we need to build a larger picture, because my impression after leaving is that in many ways I saw the innovative spirit and the practical operational reflection of that innovation on the ground declined. That was my overall impression, and I think we need to be more reflective about what failed, rather than constantly talk about the new cool thing. I know there's an imperative in terms of budgetary needs and attractive donors, obviously, to stay alive. But in order for the innovative dynamic to really move forward, we have to keep track of what didn't work and why. And first and foremost in my mind, and I still feel bad about it, is really the sort of the decline of humanitarian information centers, the HIPs, that were started in 1999 in Pristina, in Kosovo. These were the coordinating geographical information systems and satellite-based units providing information to the identity and all of the other NGOs. And these were fantastic. This was innovation a long time ago. And they were phenomenal. People who were attracted to this were excellent. And the interesting thing was they were using geographic information systems in San Francisco, not just to manage data, but to produce new information, to produce insights that couldn't have been obtained through normal field surveys. And over the course of many years, the HIPs have declined, and all of these analysts, they were technicians, but they're also analysts, analysts to generate new information, new insight about how to improve camp surveys and how to evaluate the efficiency of a particular activity. That profile was transformed internally, especially with OSHA, to the FIS, where a lot of people, the colleagues that I worked with for many years, were no longer allowed to do analysis. They were really transformed into sort of managers of existing information, and I really think it's sort of a tragic loss of capacity. I really would love to hear more about why that happened, maybe how we might recapture that dynamic engine of not just innovation but new sources of information generation. And sorry, just last thing for an appeal. All of the actual emergency responses and natural disasters that I was involved in, I saw a chronic, systematic failing of the UN system to take advantage of the local skill sets, the technical skill sets of the affected population. And first and most powerfully in my mind, burned into my mind, is meeting with a young group of, I think, 10 women who had survived the Asian tsunami in Bangladesh. They had just graduated with GIS skills, and they went to the UN, they pleaded to do all of the mapping analysis, and essentially they were just kept outside the tent for weeks. And we parachuted in all of these people when the foreign staff don't need to be there. They're local staff, their role is to evaluate that local.
Thank you. So when you look at innovate, how to learn, how can we learn better? Synopsis.
But actually, this comes from what you're mentioning is about avoiding reinventing the wheel. It's not actually capturing this huge element of history, experiences within the organization, and actually always finding new. And if nothing, it's the first time you do an emergency response. And this is what, unfortunately, you need to have some management, you need to have some systems to capture this. Otherwise, it will not happen, especially because, to your point, you're working in a very fragmented world and in many operations. How do you concise this? And there is, you know, and that's the beauty of this conference. The first time, actually, we're all together talking about these issues, and this really celebrates your leadership and your support for this to happen. The first time we actually were doing this collaboratively, but the element of gathering this information is central, and it's not about creating databases, because the moment you create a database, it's obsolete. It's about leveraging the community of practice. We have Jackie, our head of a Learn Lab, actually working very symbiotically with our division on education to be connected to the emergency network, education in emergency network, That's within your practice. It's a leading community. And I think we have to do more of this than creating new databases. It's really about, and social media is actually essential to this, because this vibrant, living flows of information is to be captured somewhere. And this community of practices are, in my sense, the best place to do so.
I think it's not clear to me whether you say positive, but all of those points are very valid. I personally have worked in information management systems and we don't know about the hack. So that speaks to the need to learn and maintain the knowledge that we gather. I think our experience in UNICEF and sort of across this group of collaborating agencies has been that we start with like quotidian ways of learning and sharing information, but that's okay, right? So having a spot on our website, which we now do, dedicated to innovation and work across the sectors is something that seems pretty basic, but has been quite effective. We also have a blog site so that colleagues in the field working on innovations, but not as innovations people, can write and share their experiences, and it's all there. The commitment to openness and transparency is definitely core to our work. And we document both our successes and failures. The team in New York organizes Fail Fridays every week, which people are welcome to come to, they rarely do. But we've also started getting traction with donors to organize larger Fail Fairs. And we've done this twice in New York with UNICEF's US Fund and NYU. And starting to also break down the ivory tower perception of the UN and let other people come to us with suggestions and learning is something that I think we need to do more of, definitely. And that was a question actually during the commissioner's address about what is the role of the UN in sort of tracking innovations, what is the role of the UN in sharing information and making sure we're not having a repetitive effort or getting more. So thank you for raising that. Still not sure if it was positive, but it's worth our discussion. And I think we'll talk a lot about that issue over the next week.
In the last 5 minutes, we'll allow as many voices as we can. I think we'll take a cluster of questions and then we'll come back to the panelists' final remarks to address any of the questions you wish to. Gentlemen,
here. My name is Darren Sarwan from the International Committee of the Red Cross. Well, thank you very much. You really are coming in. Question is challenges that you face in building partnerships outside the UN. Just interested in hearing about the experiences of being. And, you know, how do you feel?
Thank you. Just 2 rows in front, I think.
That's an announcement from my sister. But to know how you factor or you integrate, you know, the possible problem associated with new technology, disrupting, using, you know, intrusive technology, disrupting local balance, undermining the local authorities, etc. The risk associated to the new technologies, and how to tackle your research.
Yes, my name is Jette Michaels from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Denmark. I would like to hear you elaborate on the risk of setting up power and systems for innovation, and I'm talking about how to place and make sure that governments and countries and of course also local communities are in the driving seat. And this is also a challenge in terms of scaling up. You need to do much more of South-South cooperation. I heard that also from the panel, the changing situation of countries becoming middle-income countries, even having quite other capacities installed. So we have had for very many years a situation where the international human time system has sort of been delivering from outside. This is definitely changing, and it's changing for the UN. So I think this is also in terms of innovative thinking, you need to have to facilitate in a different way. So it would be good to hear concrete examples of how you go about that, and also the ownership of innovative tools and databases. It is clear that there's a skepticism with very many countries that see that the UN Association owning these databases and tools are being evaluated from outside. I think this is also a challenge for donor countries. So how can we go about changing this?
Yeah, no.
In the context, particularly protracted displacement around refugee populations, my question is really, how do we manage to move innovation beyond the spaces in which we can get away with it? Because all too often, it's the grey space in the absence of the kind of rights that we need for development that we're working in. So how do we institutionalize innovation? How do we bring in post-government? How do we bring in NGOs, government structures of the South into this discussion? And at what point is the time right to do that?
I promise it's a very short question. I'm Julia Stewart from the European Commission, and it's about old technology and language, and specifically the UN. Do you have to be able to speak English to collaborate with the UN on innovation, or have you got ways to tackle that?
We've got a lot on the table and some great questions, and we've only got 2 minutes in which to answer.
Good question.
In perhaps 1 minute each. I go on the topics and themes that matter to you. And Olivia, you're a thinker.
No, I'm just a very big on partnership. The organization has to be readily very mainly available to partner with external entities such as corporations and foundations. And your legal system has to be adapted. The due diligence system to be in place. And it has to be done quick in order to be responding with agility to the demand of the private sector. So the organization, the short answer is, you need to have your organization ready in order to partner effectively with the private sector in particular.
Yes, I should agree with what Olivier was saying. Indeed, we are working in a space in which, in the past, it was always the UN, the government, the beneficiaries. Now, definitely, the role of the private sector is becoming critical. And of course, this is good news because the private sector can bring in new solutions, can bring in innovation. Definitely, their R&D is better than our R&D, and nothing wrong about that. But yes, we have to find the new ways to define this new balance. And make really a win-win situation for everybody. And I think that while I'm not saying that it is wrong that each agency has its own innovation apparatus and that innovation is focused on the work of the agency, that is definitely something that is essential. But we have to learn much more how to work cross-sector and how to establish innovation beyond certain sectors and to become a much more cross-sectoral, cross-functional in order to have more of a comprehensive approach to innovation.
Just to respond to Yetta's question about a concrete example of not creating a parallel system in the Philippines, we engaged. We had someone who was dedicated to looking at how we work with local businesses and the local business community, and we did that through a network of business associations that was pretty well organized in the Philippines. So it was a ready interlocutor for us. But I think that's a model that could be looked at in other cases, so not just looking at corporate private partners, but really local business organizes a group to think about what their role is and their
response. Good. So I'd like to maybe make an appeal rather than offer insight, because I'm probably a better place to ask than offer at this point. But looking at the issues around how do you put governments and communities in the driver's seat, how do we look at doing innovation on a broader scale, not just where we can do it. But I think it's a really good question, actually, because that's what we do. Right. So I'd like to appeal to everybody here to have discussions over the next 2 days about what our role as the UN can be in starting to usher a process through which those players in the spaces where we can't currently get away with it sit and engage, so that we start to go in silos, be more cross-sectoral, et cetera, and actually learn what our value addition in this space is. I think that we've been doing a lot of soul searching as agencies and as the UN to learn how to innovate within our institution. And so perhaps we've overstretched in certain areas. I think it's time for us to now look again at what this room are and how we can get together as a community so that we can start to have a truly ecosystem level group partnerships and group processes that guide the work. So hopefully by the end of tomorrow, those will be at least some of the ideas that I get to promote with throughout this
We have a coffee break until there's a coffee served over in the after room. After that, all of the breakout sessions are in the rooms in this building. But before you go, I'd like to ask you to join me in thanking all of the panelists for joining us.
Let me talk about